Welcome to Music Mountain. That was pianist Fei-Fei performing Ennio Morricone's playing Love from the movie The Legend of 1900, written in 1998. So today we feature Fei-Fei as our artist, and she will be performing later Chopin, Rachmaninoff, and Robert Schumann. So stay with us for a wonderful hour of conversation and music with acclaimed pianist Fei-Fei. Praised for her bountiful gifts and passionate immersion into the music she touches, the plain dealer, pianist Fei-Fei is a winner of the Concert Artists Guild competition and a top finalist at the 14th Van Cliburn International Piano Competition. She continues to build a reputation for her poetic interpretations, charming audiences with her passion, piquancy, and tenderness, and winning stage presence, says the Dallas Morning News, both in the US and internationally. Fei-Fei was showcased prominently as a Cliburn finalist in the documentary film Virtuosity, premiered on PBS, and has offered riveting performances at Music Mountain since 2017. This past season took her across the globe in concerto performances, recitals, and chamber music collaborations alike. Highlights include performances with the Baden-Baden Philharmonic in Germany, the New York Youth Symphony in Spain, the Costa Rica National Symphony Orchestra, Columbus Symphony, Big Springs Symphony, and Symphony in C. Let me bring Fei-Fei on board. Welcome. How are you?
Hi, Oscar. Yes, wonderful to see you.
Yes, thank you so much for your time and for your beautiful playing. What a romantic, starter. What brought you to play Ennio Morricone's music?
Well, I recorded the video actually at home in New York City, and in memory of Ennio Morricone, who passed away very recently. The Legend of 1900 is one of my favorite films growing up. It's about a pianist's life who was born on a ship, and who had this found incredible talent of playing the piano, and became this remarkable pianist, and attracted a lot of tourists to go on this cruise and to hear him play. And the excerpt I played is the love theme from the movie where he fell in love with this girl. And it's one of the most memorable scenes from the movie because the pianist is not a very verbal character. It's quite introverted in terms of his feelings. So that scene, he never, I think, explicitly expressed his affection for this girl, but he was recording his album and all of a sudden he saw this girl walking past the windows, and his eyes just followed her through while improvising this tune on the piano. So I really loved that scene, and I thought I would play that just in memory of this a great composer who has left behind such a great legacy.
Yes, well said. Wow, beautiful. No, that was so gorgeous. So let me ask you, this is always the starting question. So what have you been up to during the pandemic? I mean, when was the last concert that you played in person? And since then, what projects have kept you busy?
Okay, I think my last concert was in mid-March in the US, and I was supposed to leave to Germany and Switzerland in the second half of March. And of course, because of the travel bans and pandemic, I had to cancel. And since then, because before the pandemic, my life used to be on the road and traveling a lot. So actually, at first, I really enjoyed living life on a slower pace and just having time to do a lot of things that I like doing, but normally didn't have time to. So personally, I have been exploring more of my interest. Like, I love language, so I started learning some German and also just reading, writing more. But I think musically, the whole music world, arts world, is exploring and experimenting a lot of ways to stay connected and keep sharing music in different ways. And I've also been just experimenting. I know cellist Yo-Yo Ma, he started this hashtag songs of comfort and songs of hope movement, I would say. So I've also been kind of responding to that, recording short music videos from home and sharing them on social media, just the music that gives me solace and consolation during this time. And also I've been involved with more virtual teaching, virtual masterclasses, lectures, as well as judging online competitions. So I feel
Tell us about the competition, and then I will touch on the masterclass, because that's our next clip. But so what competition is coming up, or what work have you been doing?
So I have been, for coming up, I'm this month judging an online competition, a Shanghai International Online Competition. I'm quite impressed and astonished by how many creative ways people have come up with moving everything online. And in a way, I feel like there's a lot of advantage because now I can take part in not only projects in the States, but really anywhere in the world. So I have done a lot of projects with in China as well. So there's no geographical limitation. So that's nice.
That's wonderful. Then I was checking on some of your videos. I mean, very, very impressive work, Fei-Fei. I saw some video by Tone Bass, in which you play the Prelude number 17 and 16 of Chopin. What is Tone Bass?
I don't know. It's Tone Bass. Tone Bass piano. It's a new and very exciting piano platform, and it's welcoming basically pianists, professional or amateur, of all levels, featuring kind of an array of piano lessons with different master teachers. And they really have a wonderful roster of speakers, including, you know, professors like Jerome Lowenthal, Garrick Olsen, and Leon Fleischer. So I was really excited to be part of that. So I did my teaching on the second half of Chopin Preludes, which is, Chopin is one of my favorite composers. So I chose this piece, this collection. So I think for the purpose of that platform and to benefit all levels of pianists to view this. So I think what you are going to see is some excerpts from this production. It's the Preludes number 17 and 16. I talked some about the technical aspects of playing this piece, some of the technical challenges, as well as my musical inspiration of playing these works.
No, it's wonderful. Yes, we'll watch your masterclass on so Etude number 17 in A flat major out of the 24 preludes, opus 18 by Chopin. And then after that, we will go immediately into number 16 in B flat minor, prelude number 16, which is a very short performance, lasts about 1 minute because you play so fast. No, it's quite virtuosic and brilliantly played. So I look forward to sharing that with everybody.
Okay.
Shall we hear it? Let's do this. Here we go.
Number 17, a quarto calls this prelude, She Told Me I Love You. So I always like to think the beginning two measures, which is just repeating chords. And as kind of the heart fluttering. And then when the theme comes in, I think, and I think Quarto's title is so inspiring and so fitting to this part, because it's in a situation where you hear a great news and it's almost like too good to be true, too hard to believe. And this, there's still kind of, there's a certain tenderness and shy kind of a feeling to it, but you couldn't help feeling really joyous. And I think the difficult part of playing this piece is because the accompaniment is this constant repeating chords, and the melody is hidden in the top part of the right hand. So how to practice the accompaniment not to be overpowering, how to bring out the melody from this texture and still make it sing and legato. And one thing I feel so beautiful with this part is the intervallic leaps and steps. So I feel like we need an extra sense of sensibility to feel these intervals reaching up and falling down. And apparently this was Mendelssohn's favorite prelude, because this is so much in the style of Song Without Words. So one more time, the beginning. And I feel like this 8-measure phrase, each 2 measures, each short fragment of this piece should have different colors and different kind of way of speaking. The first is, and then this is more open. Very tender and closing. And the second statement of the theme is everything, the emotion is reinforced, as if this is, you are starting to accept and believe that she loves you, and you are feeling incredibly joyous. Again, through this inharmonic note, the A flat to G sharp, we modulate. And this part, I really think it's a dialogue between two hands. And then we bring out the left hand's chromaticism. Closing material for the opening. Echo. And then we have a moment of suspension before we lead back to the third statement of this opening theme. Statement is the most, I think, most grand out of the three, and I imagine this is the part where this couple is like making vows to each other. Thank you. And the coda of this piece is one of the most special. And we hear this same melody, but we hear this constant ostinato in the bass. So we're just in the world of this A-flat major, A-flat bass. And I always imagine that's kind of, coda is kind of when the emotion starts to come down, and I always imagine that's them in the hot balloon kind of slowly descending back to earth from the cloud nine back to earth. But the technical difficulty part is because this, we have this jump from this bass. So I think it's, we should prioritize to bring this out in time, and I think everything else. Three measures in the end, a coda, a codetta.
Live from Music Mountain, hearing Fei-Fei piano. That was Chopin 28 Preludes, 24 Preludes, Opus 18. And we heard first a masterclass on number 17 in A flat major, followed by a performance of Prelude number 16 in B flat minor, a fiery, short, and virtuosic prelude. And here is the artist, Fei-Fei. What an amazing performance. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Oscar.
Yeah. Wow. That was gorgeous. Whew. So let's move along. We have a lot to cover. Yeah. And mm-hmm. I was really eager to ask you about your collaboration with mm-hmm. the New York Youth Symphony and your mm-hmm. tour of Spain with them. How was that?
Yes, that was actually last summer. We mm-hmm. first played, I made my Carnegie, the Big Hall Stern Auditorium debut with the wonderful New York Youth Symphony in May. And then we did the tour of Spain the following month. It was now actually, especially looking back, it feels so surreal to be able to tour. but it was a wonderful experience. We toured through, I think, 5-6 cities, including Ronda, Madrid, Seville, Malaga. And I Well, I loved the seafood in Spain, and also just playing with this youth symphony. It's really a group of talented and amazing kids. It was a wonderful experience. Yeah.
Yes. I have two secrets for you. No more. So you actually, the first secret, well, it's not a secret. I grew up in Spain. And so when I, you know, I hear this from you, it's so wonderful. It brings me memories of Spain. The second one is actually when I moved to New York City to further my studies, one of the first groups with which I played was the New York Youth Symphony. So I was a member.
That's amazing. Yes, yeah. That's amazing.
So in the next excerpt, furthermore, right, Rachmaninoff Concerto Number 2, we chose the second movement, which has these gorgeous solos in the piano, of course, but also on the clarinet.
Yes, it's very much a conversation between the piano and the clarinet.
Yes. So how do you select the piece? Did you propose Rachmaninoff 2, or was it proposed to you, or somewhere in between?
Yeah, it was suggested to me by the orchestra, but if I could have picked on my own, I would probably pick the same piece, because Rachmaninoff's second piano concerto was the first piano concerto I learned when I was 11. So I feel like it's been growing with me for a long time, and I associate many very beautiful memories with playing this work, and it's definitely one of the most beloved piano concerto as well. And I'll maybe just say a few words about this work, and especially about this movement.
Please.
This concerto was a comeback piece for Rachmaninoff from quite a dark period of time for him. His first symphony was not a success. It was poorly received. And after that, he lost his confidence and went into a dark time of depression. And he went through a lot of treatments to try to get better. And one of the things he tried was hypnotherapy. So in this movement, we would hear this deliberately obscured triplet rhythm. I think that reminds us of the hypnotizing effect of maybe his therapy. And on top of that, we hear this beautiful, heart-wrenching melody that's so characteristic of Rachmaninoff, because it's very so vulnerable, and it comes from maybe a very depressed place, but it has so much hope, so much longing and yearning kind of sense. Yes.
Wow. No, that's wonderful. And it was written in 1900.
Yes.
What's happening in today's program? There is a theme of love and of 1900. Yeah. It's wonderful. No, it's really nice. I must say that, you know, your performances are always so involved and so expressive. You know, so, you know, it really shows the aspect of this music that we are listening to today very well. You do a great job. So
thank you. Yeah, we included a lot of romantic music, and certainly romantic genre is one of my favorite to play. Yes.
No, it's very fitting at this time when many people are still in place. I mean, at home and just waiting for the pandemic to pass. So hopefully this will serve to warm up everybody's hearts.
Yes.
And remember that the program is interactive. You can simply email us at info@musicmountain.org, or you can also send us a comment or a question in the chat. So we are at the same time on Facebook Live and on YouTube. And also, you can simply visit our website, musicmountain.org, and there on the homepage, there is a large window. You click on the play button, and there we are, live with Fei-Fei, really having a great time here. So let's move on and listen to Rachmaninoff, Piano Concerto Number 2 with the New York Youth Symphony, Fei-Fei Piano at El Escorial in Spain, just northwest of Madrid. Here we go. Mm-hmm. That was Fei-Fei, live from Music Mountain, performing Rachmaninoff's Concerto No. 2 in C minor, the second movement, Adagio Sostenuto, playing with the New York Youth Symphony and conductor Michael Repair at San Lorenzo del Escorial in Spain. Let's bring our featured artist, acclaimed pianist Fei-Fei. Wow, what a beautiful performance.
Thank you, Oscar. Yes, looking at this video just makes me miss be able to share music live with audience so much. Yes, I hope the pandemic will get better very soon and we can connect in person and share music together again.
Yes, indeed. Wow. No, great memories and so such a beautiful music. So let's move forward a little more. And before we reach our last selection today, I wanted to ask you about your career. Very, very impressive career. And especially every time I have artists that are young, but no more, you know, like a really young artist, I ask them, so how was it to go from what we call a young artist in your early 20s or teens to becoming a professional concert pianist with a career, with a successful career?
Just a little background about myself. I grew up in China, in Shenzhen, a city in the southern part of China, very close to Hong Kong. And I came over to study at the Juilliard School when I was turning 18. After I came to the US, I also did some competitions, including, you know, the Aspen Music Festival competition, and then later in the Cliburn competition. And I think all of these opportunities opened up a lot of doors for me that I was able to start performing while I was in school. And after I graduated, I did the Concert Artist Guild and was able to win the audition and get management, and that helped me further with just traveling and playing in more and more places. Yes.
Oh, that's great. How was it to participate in the Cliburn? I mean, that's as big as it gets.
Yes, it was a very memorable experience. And the competition itself, it's because I was still a student, I think it definitely gave me a taste of what it is like to be a full-time touring concert pianist, because within the short period of time, I think it was 3 weeks, we had to play a vast amount of repertoire, including 3 solo recital programs, and chamber music, and 2 concertos. So I think it definitely gave me an authentic taste of what it is like to be, you know, presenting different programs all the time. And also it made me, I feel like made me mature in many ways. And also it's extra memorable because I think it was my first visit to Texas, and we all, as part of the competition, each contestant stayed with the host family, and the host families are just amazing. They are so supportive, and they've really become like my home, second home away from home in the States. And they're like my US family now. So it's a wonderful experience.
No, that's so great. You know, as we were listening to the Rachmaninoff, I could hear a little background noise. And now that you mentioned Shenzhen, you know, I kind of put two and two together in my imagination in a weird way. Why not sharing, you know, nostalgia? So my first trips to China, they were in 98, 99, I forget, to Hong Kong. And so from Hong Kong, I went to Chengdu in Sichuan. But so I went by ferry from Hong Kong to Shenzhen to take the airplane in Shenzhen, because it was, I guess, cheaper, probably. to go.
Oh, if I was a little older, I would have come greet you in China.
You probably were not born yet. No. No, but yes. And then the memories of performing at the conservatory in Sichuan and other conservatories in China, where, you know, when a guest artist came, it was like a big celebration.
Yes.
We were, you know, having banquets all the time, and the concerts were very well attended. I mean, by the thousands. Even in the conservatory, I remember the concert hall was full, and they opened the backside, I guess, like in Tanglewood. So it was, you know, open to the outdoors. And people were coming and going, and there were children, and there were families, and there were students and professors, and everybody was having a good time enjoying this guy's clarinet playing. No, but really welcoming, really welcoming. I continue to go back to China every year until 2002, and thereafter less. And as you know, I mean, Shenzhen has gone through an enormous change. I mean, it's a it's completely different. Within 20 years, maybe where there were no houses at all, now they are skyscrapers and highways. So it has grown so much, that area of the world. It's great. So how was it for you to grow up there, and how was it to play Western music at the conservatory there in Shenzhen, China?
Well, in Shenzhen, Shenzhen, the city itself is definitely like a miracle, because 30 years ago, it was a fishing village, like a very rural part. And it was later designated as a special economic zone. So they started to do factories and more high-tech experiments, and it really bloomed into this metropolitan city. Now it's one of the top cities in China. In a way, it's very similar to New York, because it's an immigration city. We have people from all over the country as well as all over the world. So when I came to New York, I didn't feel much of a cultural shock at all, because I'm very used to live in a big city with people from everywhere. So I think one of the benefits of growing up in Shenzhen, it's very close to Hong Kong. And after Hong Kong returned to China in 1997, it was much easier to go across. So I, growing up, I always went over to hear concerts. So I had very early access to really world-class concerts. And I think for my parents' generation, they didn't have a lot of opportunities to study, especially Western music. So I would say around my generation, it's really the first generation that has had the opportunity to access so much Western music. So for sure, there is so much enthusiasm, curiosity, and passion about you know, listening and studying and appreciating Western music. And yeah, too bad this year I was supposed to go on a 12-city tour with my trio in China in June, and that also has to be postponed. But yes, playing China, it's the audience is so, especially we see a lot of younger kids in the audience, which is wonderful. Yeah.
Yes, indeed. Do you study at the Shenzhen Conservatory or Wanzhou?
No, actually, I studied privately in Shenzhen until I didn't attend any pre-college or of sorts before I came to Juilliard. Yes, which is kind of unusual in China, because in China, if you want to study music professionally, you usually go to a pre-college, which is a full-time system, instead of like in the US, it's a weekend program. But my parents, because of my parents' work, and it was not possible for me to go enroll in a full-time music program. And also I had a very good, great teacher that I wanted to keep studying with. So I just kind of studied privately. Yes.
Oh, that's great. Is driving more civic now than in the early 2000s in Shenzhen?
What is more civic? Driving? Well, I think, not sure. It's probably more aggressive now.
So this is how you would put the left signal when I was there. You would invade the other channel, the other lane. And then as you approach the crossroads, everybody obviously stops or they have an accident. And then you make a left at the intersection.
Yes.
Speed limit, as fast as you can go. Bicycle distance, 2 inches, why more? Yes. That's sufficient.
I think they now banned motorcycles on the road, so which makes it a little bit less traffic and a little bit safer.
Yes.
So I think.
When I went, I just couldn't get over it. It was frightening. Frightening. Driving was frightening.
Yes. Wow. That's why I think very much like New York City. Very aggressive driving for sure.
Wow. So so wonderful to actually segue into our last piece in the program, which is scenes from childhood, from a different childhood and that of Robert Schumann's, right? Mm-hmm. So let's talk a little bit about this piece, which I read, so Robert wrote while his wife-to-be, Clara Wieck, or Clara Schumann, was away, was on tour. She was a fine pianist. And so while she was away, he got to composition, wrote 30 or so small pieces, and then made a selection of 30 for the scenes from childhood. But I'm sure you have a lot more to say about this piece. So what kind of piece is it for you? Why did you choose this piece?
This piece, well, Schumann is one of my other favorite composers. I say the romantic composers, Schumann, Rachmaninoff, and Chopin are my most favorite. And he is, his language yet is so different from Chopin and Rachmaninoff. He's one of the most imaginative composers. This piece is a collection of 13 miniatures, 13 character pieces. So each one is so contrasting and captures a different activity or childhood imagery. And this piece is not just a set of simple pieces for children to appreciate, but I really think it's an adult, Schumann as an adult, looking back on his childhood memories. And for example, in the end of this collection is called The Poet Speaks. And that's not a childhood activity, but really the composer. He is inserting his voice in this piece to conclude this set. And of course, one of the most beloved and popular part of this work is number 7, Traumerei. And I remember as a kid, one of my first music videos that I saw was Horowitz playing this work in Moscow. And I remember when he was playing the Traumerei, the camera shifted to an audience member, and he was a gray-haired man, and he was expressionless sitting there, but if you look closely, you could see there was tears coming down his face. Back then, I was so young, I was probably like 6 or 7. I didn't understand this music in a deep way then. But when I saw that, I felt the power of music, of how it could affect and inspire people, inspire feelings and emotions in people. That was always one of the imagery or scene that I always remembered in my head. And this piece is definitely one of my favorite by Schumann.
Wow. Yeah. Beautiful. we have a comment here I wanted to share with you and our audience. This is Alan writing. He writes, "What a wonderful treat to watch Fei-Fei's phenomenal playing from our house in Fayetteville, Arkansas, while my parents watch from Connecticut. Our our entire family has loved every week." Best Alan. Thank you so much, Alan. Thank you for sending us your comment via email in this case. So people can write to us via email or in the chats, either in YouTube or Facebook. So Let's hear this wonderful Schumann. But before we go, Fei-Fei, So what's coming up for you? What's next? What are some of your upcoming projects?
I have some recording projects coming up, solo as well as chamber music next week. I'm recording some quartets with the New Asia Chamber Music Society next week in New York. And also I'm going to be judging the online competition that I mentioned earlier, the Shanghai online piano competition, this recording commentaries and that this month.
No, that's wonderful. And I hope our audience will run to Fei-Fei's YouTube channel after this program, because you do have a lot of videos there that are wonderful. And it's so great to hear you, Fei-Fei. Very, very wonderful. So thank you so much for joining us. And let's listen to Schumann. Thank you so much.
And thank you. Thank you, Oscar. It's lovely to see you.
Yes. Likewise. Stay well. And we look forward to hearing you at Music Mountain very soon. Touch wood, fingers crossed, and everything else, so that we can return in 2021. I'm sure there is a vaccine. We are all eventually coming out. I hope so. And we'll play in person, and we'll hear you play in person at Music Mountain.
Yes.
Take care. Ciao, ciao. That was pianist Fei-Fei, live from Music Mountain, performing Robert Schumann's Scenes from Childhood, Opus 15, written in 1838, when Schumann was 28 years old, and while his wife-to-be, pianist Clara Wieck, was on tour. Before we go, we have a quick announcement to make about the next 3 weeks. So we are introducing a new schedule. Please take note. Of course, we'll write this on our website shortly, but here is the plan. Next Sunday, August 16th, we will go live at 5 p.m. instead of 3, at 5 p.m. That's next week. The week following, on the 23rd, we will go live at 1 p.m. And on the 30th, we will go live at 8 p.m. So if 3 p.m. was not your ideal time, we have much to choose from in the next 3 weeks. Remember, these programs remain available on our website. So if you are not able to come live and join us and send us comments in real time, you can always visit our website, musicmountain.org, and enjoy the programs at your own time. The reason why we are going to shift times is because we really want to have a close look at what is happening right now regarding COVID-19. We are at the universities getting ready to start the new academic year. Performing arts centers are getting ready to decide in September if in-person concerts are safe. Starting January, most series are canceled through the beginning of January. So we thought it would be really helpful to bring onto the program artists from around the world who live in countries where the pandemic is starting to be behind and where they are starting to get back to in-person concerts. So next week, we will have the New Zealand String Quartet. This is on the 16th of August, and it will be at 5 p.m. because that is their 9 a.m. on Monday. So that's why we're meeting at 5 p.m. next Sunday, August 16th. We will be featuring the New Zealand String Quartet, which performed at Music Mountain in 2007. So we will be very, very happy to catch up with our old friends. They will play Debussy and also several works by New Zealand composers. The week after that, the 23rd of August, we are meeting at 1 p.m. because we're going to have a masterclass. Around this time of the year is when the Music Mountain Academy takes place. This year, it is not taking place in person, but we will have an alumna, Elena Ariza, cello, perform in our masterclass at 1 p.m. on August 23rd. And the guest artist giving the masterclass will be Ben Zander. Ben Zander, the founder and music director of the Boston Philharmonic Orchestra, and also author of the national bestseller, The Art of Possibility. Elena will be playing Haydn Concerto for cello, and we hope that we will have other students join and the public join and ask questions to participate. And on the last Sunday in August, August 30th, we will be meeting at 8 p.m. in the evening. So after the day is over, join us, please. At 8 p.m., we will be presenting the Casate String Quartet, and we will be including Michiko Oshima, who is the former viola of the Casate String Quartet, who resides in Japan. So after we know about how artists are doing in New Zealand next Sunday, we will know about how artists are doing in Japan on August 30th. And hopefully we'll get some insights about how slowly and safely we might all get back to in-person concerts. Remember, all these concerts, all these live streams are interactive, and you can join us by sending us an email to info at musicmountain.org, or if you're on YouTube, you can send us any comments or questions in the chat, which we observe during the show, as well as on Facebook Live. Of course, you can always enjoy it just by visiting our website, but there is no chat there. So you can perhaps then chat with us via email, if that works for you. And the Cassata String Quartet on August 30th will be playing works by Andy Terstein, Daniel Godfrey, and Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. So that's the plan for the rest of August. We will put all this on our website, but here we go. You got it first, exclusively, for joining our Live from Music Mountain program today. And before we go, we just started our summer campaign. We have the goal of raising $15,000 through October. If you can, please visit our website and send us your support in the form of a small contribution. We need your support. And also, thank you. Thank you very much, because in July, we managed to raise over $12,000 in the Northwest Corner Gives campaign, which was slated to raise $10,000. So we surpassed that campaign. Thank you very much for making that possible. And without any further ado, I think we are ready. No more announcements. Just making sure. Yep, no more announcements here. So please stay safe. Please come back next Sunday and please participate. I hope these programs are of some comfort, and I hope you're enjoying them. We always welcome your feedback, so don't hesitate to send us an email or call us. Have a great week. Thank you very much.